So I'll be discussing the problem of how the general problem of navigation, and I guess in all the scales that you'll be seeing in this course, this seminar will fit at the level of behavior, at the behavioral level. So behavior, of course, is quite special in the chain that goes from sensing the environment by biological systems. And then you have the processing of this information that you've seen this morning. There's the transduction pathway or the neural systems that have been discussed. And then there's decision making. And then at the end, you get to the outcome being the behavior of the animal, of the organism. And that's clearly what is most directly under selective pressure, which of course doesn't mean that behavior is the most important thing in this chain. Ideally, what you would like to have is an understanding that goes from the sensing of environmental information up to the behavior. Now, if you look at navigation in terms of this scheme, there's two main extremes in terms of navigation, orientation, or motility. I mean, these are all different words for the same things, for how cells or animals move in the environment. And on the one hand, you have E. coli or bacteria, where I would say it's quite well understood in terms of the phenomenology and the behavior, run and tumble. It's quite clear how this produces a biased random walk, and this allows the bacteria to move in a certain direction. It's also quite well understood, thanks to the works of Howard Berg and collaborators, how the molecular pathway works. There's a very good understanding of this. What is missing in that field is more what is the evolutionary pressure, exactly what kind of environment C. coli has been selected for, which seems like a trivial problem, but it's not, because E. coli is living in the gut, and it's very hard to visualize what's going on in the gut, what kind of concentration, what kind of fields are in the environment, and even less when E. coli is outside in the environment. It's not clear what exactly is experiencing, what's the environment. So we don't quite understand what's going on at the level of the evolutionary pressures. Now, this would be a different talk, but what I would like to discuss today is the other extreme of navigation, which are these two examples of macroscopic animals, so much bigger than E. coli. Now we're talking about scales that are those of insects and birds, so we go from several centimeters to even meters. And in this case, we have, it's quite the opposite. It's because we can observe them quite easily. It's clear what these behaviors, which I will discuss today. One is the olfaction-guided navigation, olfactory searches by insects. And then on the other hand, I'll be discussing the thermal soaring by birds, which is the phenomenon that you might have seen, these birds that are ascending currents. So it's quite clear evolutionarily why they do these kind of things. On the other hand, we have very little understanding of the molecular mechanism, of the neural mechanism that control this kind of behavior. And I'll try to convince you that we are getting a little bit of understanding on how they, on the behavior, on the phenomenology of how they move and what exactly they are sensing and how they exploit this information. So let me get started. And of course, it's a seminar, but feel free to interrupt anytime if anything is not clear. So let me get started with the first one of the two, which is the olfaction-guided navigation. And let me start by the phenomenon itself. So what's the phenomenon of olfactory searches? What's the observation? The observation is here. You have females, moths. This is a picture of a male moth, and these are the antennae where you have all the receptors of molecules, which are called pheromones, which are sent out by females that are typically sitting on trees. So the source of pheromone, you should imagine that these are branches of trees where you have these females that are sending out pheromones. These pheromones typically are a mixture of different molecules, and the emission rate is relatively low and relatively tiny, is a few picograms per second. And these molecules have molecular weights of a few hundred Daltons. It's not important, this number. The main message which these few hundred Daltons should convey is that these are molecules that do not sink. So they can fly and they can be transported by the wind. They stay aloft and they can get far away even on distances of 100 meters. So they don't sink. Now, these molecules, as I said, are not particularly, even the concentration at the source is not particularly dense. But of course, it gets transported by the wind and by the atmospheric winds. And then what happens is that males that are flying in the environment, they can be even hundreds of meters away, they detect some of these molecules. And then they get into this very stereotyped pattern that you see here that entomologists have distinguished two phases in these patterns. One phase, which is called zigzag. Zigzag is this one here. The arrows are the local directions of wind. So you see that in these phases, what the moth, the male moth, is doing is that it's moving consistently upwind. And then you have other phases, which are this one, of casting. Casting is phases where the moth cuts the wind at an angle which is important. It can even go to the limit like here, which is cutting the wind perpendicular, or it can even go downwind, like in this case here. And the observation is that with this kind of patterns, and the male moths are able to reach the females in time scales of the order of a few minutes. So they have to cover hundreds of meters with these very tiny concentrations, and they get to the source in time scales of the order of minutes. Now, evolutionarily, it's quite clear that this is an important phenomenon. Why they do it, it's obvious, because this is about mating, it's about reproduction, so it's obviously under selective pressure. Now, why is this problem? I said at the beginning, it's very much in the opposite side of the spectrum compared to bacterial chemotaxis. So this slide is to explain why physically, and this has to do with physics, why this is very different from the case of chemotaxis. And it has to do with the scales. As I said, these are scales of the order of tens of meters. So they're very different from the spatial scales of E. coli chemotaxis, which are maximum millimeters. Now, if we look at distances of the order of tens or hundreds of meters, of course, this is not happening by molecular diffusion. Outside there, this is getting transported by the wind, and it's getting transported in particular by atmospheric turbulent winds, because it's unavoidable that on scales of the order of hundreds of meters, there will be a turbulence, which is important. Now, if you look at turbulence is very different from molecular diffusion. Turbulence tends to mix stuff and to produce strong gradients, which is quite the opposite of what molecular diffusion is doing. And so this is an image of a jet flow. You have a jet, so a tube here, which is pumping water. And then you have another tube here, which is injecting some fluorescent dye. And as you can see here, as you inject this fluorescent dye, it gets broken up in all these plumes and all this structure, which is extremely convoluted and complicated. And the other important message which is coming from this plot here is that if you now look at the fraction, you sit at a certain location here, and you threshold your signal. So you should imagine that the moth, as you've seen, has these antennae that are covered by receptors of pheromones. They are extremely sensitive. They can get to something of the order of 10 to the minus 15, 10 to the minus 16 moles. So essentially, if there's 100 molecules in around the antennae, they're going to pick them up. But even with 100 molecules, what's going to happen? You have a threshold, right? So we put the threshold on the signal. C0 is the concentration at the injection. And UT is the distance down here. So UT is essentially the distance downwind from the source. And what you see in this plot is the fraction, is the log of the fraction of space or time, it's the same if you average over time, that the signal is passing the threshold.
And as you can see, this is going down very fast as you go away from the source. So the message is that as you move down the source, the probability of detecting something which is above the threshold scales down quite rapidly with the distance. And now if you go 100 of meters away, anticipating a little bit on what I will tell you later on, this is the kind of signal that you should imagine that the moths are sensing. I threshold the signal, so it's one whenever the concentration is passed, the threshold of concentration, and it's zero whenever the signal is below the threshold of detection of the receptors. So what you see here is that the signal, first of all, of course, jumps from zero to one. But the important thing is that you can have very long periods that can last even 2, 3, 4 minutes where you don't detect anything, which is very different from the case of chemotaxis where you have gradients. They might be complicated to extract because of noise, but there is a gradient that can be extracted. Here, there's essentially no signal because everything is below the threshold of detection. And the issue is how can you possibly make to the source? Now, if you look at this in terms of the patterns, so these are two patterns that you could obtain assuming that the time between detections are relatively tiny. So you would get something like a tube here that you can climb. This is relatively easy to imagine how you can climb and get to the source. You should essentially have a gradient of concentration. You have a gradient of concentration, and you can get like this. This one, it's a case where the velocity of the wind is fluctuating, and then you get something which is kind of convoluted, but you can still, when you move, for example, perpendicular to the wind, you're going to get back into this channel where you have detections. And so you can, again, by tracking this plume, you can get to the source. The reality, though, is neither one of these two is the reality. The reality is more something like this, where you have patches of detections, as you see here, but then you have space between the two of them that can go up to 20 or 30 meters. So essentially, the moth have to cross this desert of these 20, 30, 40 meters where they don't detect anything, and they're able to do it and to make it to the source. And the issue is, how can they make it? Now, you might tell me, OK, that's fine. You're showing me instantaneous plots, but this is not really what I want to do. What I want to do is that I want to average my signal out, and then maybe what's going to appear is a gradient. So actually, I could average the signal and get an average signal that shows up gradients. This is true. If you average your signal, even at very large distances, you're going to get the gradient. But the time scales for these gradients to appear can be long, very long. At 100 meters, it can even take tens of minutes, 1 hour. So the point is that, and there are models that have been developed in order to describe, for instance, the mean concentrations. These are important models because, for instance, if you have a radioactive source somewhere, what you want to know is how this radioactivity or this contaminants are going to spread. And in that case, you're interested in the long-term exposure effects, for example, for the health of people. So in that case, it's very important to describe the mean, and it makes perfect sense to describe the mean. And you won't be surprised that on very long time scale, the kind of models that you get are some form of diffusion, more or less corrected and sophisticated, but it's some form of diffusion. The point, though, is that when you look at animals, the animals don't take averages. They respond on timescales of the order of 100 milliseconds. If you put some pheromones in, to expose a moth, it's going to respond in 100 milliseconds. And there's no averaging whatsoever which is being done. So the conclusion of this, and this has been shown by a beautiful classical experiment by Mafraneto and Cardet, where they showed that the moths are actually very sensitive to the frequency of the pulses that you expose. So you give them pheromones with frequencies like squares, and then you change the frequency of these squares, so the distance between the squares. And you clearly see very different behaviors in the case where the pulses are fast and the pulses are very slow. So these MOTS, they don't take averages. They respond to snapshots. And the message of this slide is that average models that have been developed for other contexts, in particular for environmental sciences, are not relevant for the case of olfactory searches. We should look at instantaneous profiles. Now, this problem I've been insisting on the biology, but in fact it's also relevant for technological applications. Yes? So 100 milliseconds, they fly at velocities of the order of not more than 1 meter per second. So it's short.
What I mean, this model of average gradient will be correct on what?
Okay. Yes. Oh, okay. Sorry, I got the wrong. So this is correct on a time scale that depend on the distance. If you are 10 meters away, there were some measurements made by Cardin collaborators that showed that you have to average for timescales of the order of 5 or 6 minutes at distances of the order of 10-20 meters. If you go to 100 meters, this is going to go up, and nobody has really measured, but we can estimate these timescales are going to be of the order of several tenths of minutes. So really off, because the timescale of the search is a few minutes, 5 or 6 minutes. So, something.
So, if the butterfly is at one position and receives some pipes of pheromone, how does he know that he has to go against the wind?
They have detectors of wind, so they know where the wind is coming from, the local direction of wind. And so what they do is that the typical behavior is that whenever they detect something, what is thought is that in these phases here, they have these detectors of wind. So they detect some molecules, and they assume that since the molecules are coming down the wind, the most probable position from it's coming from is going to be come from in this direction. So they move upwind.
So do they follow the pheromone or the wind?
Whenever they detect the pheromones, and at the same time they also sense the wind. And what they do is that when they detect the pheromones, they search and they go upwind. Okay. Yes. Very good question. Actually, so these blends of pheromones that I've been talking about, they're species specific. So the blend, the particular composition of the blend is species specific. And so what this is probably due to is precisely to prevent what you just said, which is that you go after a female of another species that you cannot mate. There was another question. Okay, so right. So at the technological level, what you would like to do is to be able to do this on robots that are called sniffers. This is a picture of a sniffers. You can put an anemometer, as for the case of MOTS that I just discussed. There's a camera, even though it's not very useful if you want to do just olfactory searches. There's a processor, there are wheels. And then here you have what are called e-noses. E-noses are electronic noses that detect this mixture and these molecules. Now, for this case, you can ask, can I make it to the source? Because it's kind of surprising that 100 meters away from the source, you can still make it because of these physical reasons that I've been discussing. So a few years ago, what we did was to try to pose this problem, forgetting about biology, and just asking about, you want to build a robot that is able to do this kind of things, that starts at very large distances from the source, and has to get to the source of these chemicals based on detections. So this is a picture of what the strategy that we proposed, which is based on information theory, infotaxis. So what it does is that it builds a map of where the source might be located based on detections and non-detections. And then it moves in such a way as to reduce the Shannon entropy that you've seen this morning discussed in detail, so that it acquires information on the location of the source as fast as possible. And this leads to this kind of patterns that you see here, where the local direction of wind is again like this. And these are detections, the black dots. And as you can see, this is very much reminiscent of the casting that you've seen previously. And this is a phase of surge zigzag that you've seen before. There's one detection, and so it goes upwind, and then it starts casting again. Now, this was done mostly on simulations. Then Jean-Baptiste Masson, who was in Pasteur, implemented this on real robots. And then there were later works where this has been upgraded to the case of swarms of robots that move all together and communicate by Wi-Fi. So from
how did they actually detect? What's the detection mechanism of the robots? How did they sniff?
OK, good. So because I was exactly to the point of saying that receptors are not comparable to insects. So what we addressed here is the problem of what should you do if you have a good receptors. We haven't discussed, and we cannot do because it's a condensed matter problem, how can you build a good receptor? So the way we circumvented the problem here is that what we did, we put some sensors of temperature, because sensors of temperature are very good and they're very fast. So we don't have a detector of chemicals which is fast enough and sensitive enough comparable to insects. So we kind of avoided the problem by using temperature sensors. But the problem of developing receptors that can approach the kind of performance of MOTS is still completely open. And the idea is very much based on that when a molecule hits the device, there's some condensed matter devices, the resistance of the device changes, and so you pick up the fluctuations in the current, and that's the way you pick up the signal. But this is not at the level of 10 to the minus 15, 10 to the minus 16 moles. And the other thing is that it's slow, so it integrates much more on timescales that are of order of seconds.
How does it deal with the refraction period?
The refractory period of?
Well, because if it binds, it doesn't bind.
Oh, that's what the timescale, that's why the timescale is long. That's why the timescale is long. And there's a lot of activity in this, so we kind of avoided that by using temperature sensors. So this is something that I'll be happy to discuss. I presented this at the time, so I'm not going to discuss more. But if you have questions or you want to discuss later, I'll be happy to. What I would like to tell you is more what we're doing on real animals, because the problem of what animals do is still open. And so this is the picture of the behavior that I've shown you. And what do we know at the level of the neural mechanisms that are controlling this behavior? Unfortunately, we don't know much. There's a lot of progress which is happening at the level of the olfaction, at the level of the receptors, at the level of the glomeruli that are here, and canyon cells which are here. So there's a lot of progress which is being made on elucidating how these molecules bind the receptors, how this signal from the receptors goes to the glomeruli and goes to the canyon cells. But then from the canyon cells, which essentially act like coincidence detectors, that's pretty much what the image is coming out of all these works. But then what happens once this signal is being sent out to the upper part of the brain? What's the algorithm which is processing this signal? It's totally unknown. And now we can speculate what kind of mechanism can happen. Now, it's unlikely that, and that's why I stress that that work was done for robots, it's unlikely that animals are doing the same exact calculation that I've just briefly mentioned for the case of robots, essentially because insects in particular, they probably don't have a map of space. They're able to do path integration. So if they move, they're able to know to integrate their trajectory and to get back to the initial location by cutting short. So they have a sense of how they're moving, but probably they don't have a map of space, like, for instance, grid cells or place cells, like in rats. So it's unlikely that they have a map of space, and it's also unlikely that they're doing a probabilistic map of that type. On the other hand, what's been shown in the work, in particular by Jean-Baptiste in the paper that I've mentioned before, is that you don't really need a very detailed map of space. You can have a limited memory and limited sense of space, and you can still get to the source. And then what we did recently in this work here is to discuss the when people say information, in fact, you can acquire information on many different things. You can acquire information on the time, on the location of the source, on the time that it's going to take to the source. Your map might be a very detailed pixel-based map, or it could be a very coarse-grained map. All these are very different requirements in terms of information and memory. And so it's not obvious that because you don't have a map, acquiring information is not relevant at all. So to make a long story short, the case of animals, it's open. And at the moment in the field, there's two very different views about what's going on. On the one hand, you have reactive strategies, people essentially thinking that they detect something, the moths, and they search, they go upwind. And then if they don't detect for a few seconds, they get into a stereotype pattern of this casting, where they cut the wind perpendicular. And this is a completely reactive process without any cognition, without any memory of the past. And on the other hand, you have something more in the spirit of what I've shown you here, or a downgraded version, that are based more on models and based more on trying to infer what's the location of the source. And we don't know what moths are really doing. And there's a number of questions, very concrete, that one is willing to address and one should address, which is, for instance, what's the extension of the casting phases? So how this is being decided, for instance, how long does it extend the casting with respect to the wind? Is there any memory of the past detection? So imagine that there was a detection here and there was a detection here, or just one detection here. Does the moth is going to change its behavior because of the past detection, let's say, 10 seconds ago? What kind of memory of the past detection is affecting the behavior? And then, is there any sense of space? So is it important where the detection was made, because they can still make path integration? All these questions are totally open. And experiments that are very useful. The problem with experiments in the wild is that it's very hard to control at the same time the trajectories of the insects and also deliver something which you can control. You cannot have dyes and visualize the dyes over distances of hundreds of meters, because this is, you cannot have cameras, you cannot control. So it's very, it would be very useful to have the animals in the lab and deliver something which is controlled. And these are the experiments that go under the name of tethered insects, because the insects, as you can see here, they are tethered by a wire, and they're able to turn in this direction. And you can deliver by this tube, there's a fan which is coming here that delivers odors, and you can assay the response of the animals to this stimuli. Now, the problem with these experiments, they've been done mostly for visual cues. As you can see here, this is an experiment done in Dickinson's lab about the visual cues. The problem with odors is that you don't know exactly what you should deliver, because these plumes, these odors that get transported by the wind, they are not, we don't know the statistics, at least we didn't know the statistics of these detections, how they are distributed. So what we did recently was to try to figure out what's the statistics of these detections. And so essentially what you want to do is that you would like to know what's the distribution of the periods of time where the local concentration passes a threshold of concentration. So this will be the whiffs, And then you have the periods that we call blanks, where you go below the threshold of concentration, you don't detect anything. And then the height of the concentration when you pass the threshold. Now, I'm not going to get into too many details, just a sketch of the result and how we get this. We essentially track particles, and the problem reduces to the following one. If you write down the equation of a concentration transported by a velocity field, you can look at them in terms of the trajectories of the particles. And then the problem reduces to the following. You have to take a puff of particles at the point where you're detecting things. And you should look at it, let it go backward in time, and see whether or not this puff of particles overlaps with the source. And how long does it overlap with the source? So essentially, the concentration at the detection point, you have to solve a residence time of a puff of particles that go backward in time, how long they overlap with the source. Now, compared to the usual problem of residence time that we usually solve with Brownian motion, of course, the difficulty is that in this case, this is not the Brownian motion velocity which is transported the particles. So you have to do a little bit more work, but that's the same idea of getting to a residence time. And actually, the reason why we can solve the problem is that we reduce it to a very much simpler form. In general, when you have a puff of particles, you might have seen this into a cup. This is actually a cup where you stir coffee. And this is the kind of patterns that they generate. So the concentration, as you can see, is extremely convoluted on the very small scales. But in fact, probably for our problem, it's not very important, all this little convolution on the scales of millimeters, because actually the source, in our case, is the female moth. Now, the female moth is of the order of several centimeters. So probably all these convolutions and all this fine scale structure is not very important. So what we can try doing, and it seems to work pretty well, is that we forget about all the small scales, and we treat all the puff of particles just as a blob with the center of mass and the extension of the, actually we treat it as a sphere. So we just describe the center of mass and the extension of this sphere, and we look at it going backward in time. And now, this way, the problem, of course, becomes much simpler. And in particular, there's one result which seems to come out and to be quite universal and independent of the type of flow, which is that if you look at the duration of the periods of detection and the duration of the periods of non-detection, it seems to display a very broad spectrum of times. And they are distributed like the power t to the minus 3/2, both the widths and the blanks. And the physics, in fact, goes back to the random walk that I was mentioning before, because if you look at this puff of particles while it's going backward in time, imagine that at a certain time, this puff is small and it overlaps with the source. Now, what we have to assess when we look at the width's duration is whether or not this, at a later time, the puff is still overlapping with the source. Now, when you change time, there are several things that are happening. One of them is that the velocity at the large scales might change. So this might sweep your puff of particles to a different location, and it doesn't overlap anymore. The other thing is that this happens with mean velocities, which are those that transport the most. Then the size of your puff might enlarge, and therefore, it does overlap, but it overlaps over a much broader region, so the concentration goes down. These two processes, they give the cutoffs in the distribution. And the third process that happens is that the small scales will change. Now, the small scales, they change over very fast time scales, and therefore, they essentially act like random walk, but with a different diffusion, which is not the one of the molecular diffusion, but turbulent diffusion. So the message is that you might still have this one. If you look at later times, the position of this puff, it might, in fact, be random walking like here with the coefficient which is describing the effects of the small scales. And now if you ask what's the probability that an object which is moving random walking in 3D overlaps with the sphere, the distribution is t to the minus 3/2. So now you can go and check in the data whether or not this is indeed observed. And this is the experiment on jet flows that you've seen before. This is the duration of the whiffs. This is the duration of the blanks. Here we're still talking about distances of a meter. The most interesting case is the case of the atmospheric surface layer, so outside in the field, where you can go at distances comparable now to the distances of the moths, so hundreds of meters, and you see a very clean -3/2 with an exponent with the cutoffs, a small scale cutoff, which seems to go like 1/1 the distance to the source, and the large cutoff at very long durations that seem to go like x, so the distance to the source, which is what we predict. So the message is that by this kind of predictions, we are able now to have a sense of what's the statistics of the detections that the moths, or in general, this phenomenon that I discussed with moths, it's actually also observed with flies. They can detect odors. In that case, it's not for mating, it's more for food. They can sense the smell, and then they can fly. And one of the issues is that what kind of distances they can fly. I told you that in the case of moths, it's several hundreds of meters. There's classical experiments that have been done with flies, like this one in the Death Valley, where essentially you have a bunch of release of flies that are released here, and then you have two trap lines, one where you put buckets of odors. These are rotten fruits. And on the other side, you just put trap lines. And now what you do is that you move these trap lines farther and farther away, and you look at the distance such that there's a statistical difference between the capture rate between the two sides. So this way, you can estimate the distance where these flies are still sensitive to the odors. And the number that comes out, the distance is of the order of 100 meters. Now, this one is just beautiful. The only thing that we are not quite happy with is that this was done close to an oasis where the flies were born and they were raised. And so the control of turning these trap lines with respect to the oasis was not done. There could be some other signal which is not quite related to the odors. So what we're going to do is repeat this experiment, turning this trapping lines in different directions with respect also to the polarization of the light, and make sure that this is of the order of 100 meters. Once we have this distance, then we'll release in the lab odors with the statistics corresponding to those distances, and we'll assay what the flies are doing in response to this. The reason we prefer flies is that flies are much more amenable to genetics, and they're easier to manipulate than moths. And so these are the data that I've been trying to get for a few years. It seems finally that we can get them. And we'll try to figure out what's going on in the brain and what's the algorithm that they are using. Okay? So that's the first part of the talk. If you have questions on this part before I move to the soaring. Yes.
For this movement of the moth, how is the 3D parameter, the third parameter, just you only show it?
Yes. Right. So they tend to fly pretty much stratified. So they tend to stay at a certain height. So it's 2 plus 1D. It's not quite 3D. But of course, 3D is very important for the process of transport. Because typically what's happening is that it's sitting on a tree, and typically in the atmosphere what happens is that if you release particles, they tend to raise a little bit in height. So the problem of the flight itself is essentially pretty much 2D, but if you really want to understand how they get transported, the molecules of odors, then you have to work with 2 plus the stratification, so that becomes a 3D problem. Yeah, Maxime.
So you have the statistics of event detection that you showed in the previous slide, mm-hmm. this broad distribution.
Yes.
And associated with this broad distribution, so this is a very long term. You often have these weird statistics and aging processes and non-ergodicity breaking. So does it play any role, you think, in the physics of
Well, it does, yes, it does play a role, because that's precisely, I'm not sure there's a breaking of ergodicity, but the main effect of these very long tails is that you can have these long periods where the moths or the flies are not detecting anything. So that's the main effect. And whether this corresponds to a breaking of ergodicity in this case, I would say that the moth, for instance, stops searching. This could well happen. That if it doesn't detect anything for, let's say, 10 minutes, which can, well, it can happen, or 5 minutes, for instance, it might stop searching. So this is, quote unquote, the breaking of search more than ergodicity. So yes, it has an effect. And that's precisely what is shaping these patterns, and that's what's creating these long periods of non-detection.
Yep.
Any other? No, we can measure it. We can measure it. What we cannot do is that we cannot have a fly or a moth going on, and then at the same time measuring the concentration that the moth is detecting and looking at the trajectory. So you can sit at one point with the detector and measure, which is what this data are about. I mean, the way this was done is that they released something at 200 meters. They sit on a tower, and they put the detector of the whatever it is that they measure. In this case, I think it was temperature. And they measure the thing. What you would like to do, though, is to track the moth or the fly while it's flying, see what they're detecting, and at the same time look at the trajectory. So this way you would have the input and the output. Well, I guess the statistics of the order that you would like to quantify, and I think that's what we've done, is that, so you would like to know, you would like to have something which says the concentration at time x and time, at position x and time t, that's what it is with this correlation, and as a function of time, if I'm detecting something now, what's the probability that I'm still detecting something above the threshold? What's the level of concentration? And then when I'm not detecting anything, how long it's going to last. And these are the three, these are the PDFs that I'm showing you here. There's another one that I'm not showing you, which is the level of concentration, how is it distributed, and it's exponentially distributed. Okay? So if you want to generate a stochastic process like this, you would generate something, the height when you detect is exponential, and then you want to generate two processes like this, with this kind of probability distribution. Of course, you're still missing something, which is there might be correlations between several, but this is much, much less than this. So I think it's a reasonable statistics if you generate.
My question, because I would imagine you'd have to have a field of
Yes. So that one we don't quite know what it is. But this one, I think it's already much more reasonable than what was delivered so far, which was square. I mean, so far what they were delivering and the experiment of, they were delivering something like this, which probably moths have never seen in their life. And the issue is that if you deliver something like this, when they respond, do they respond physiologically? Do they respond, you know, if we get exposed to something which is non-physiologic, we might do crazy things and not the real ones. So you want to deliver something reasonable. Any other question? Okay. So let me tell you about the other phenomenon, which also, as you will see, is the phenomenon of soaring. So this is the phenomenon shown here. Here there's a GPS on a bird, and it's picking up an ascending current, which is down there, and it's spiraling around this ascending current. This is a falcon, and this was done by Vixek and collaborators a few years ago. So they put the GPS on the bird, and they looked at how it moves. And the picture here is showing the height as a function of time. And here it's not seen, but there's an ascending current which is down here, which is called thermal. Because essentially it's due to the fact that the ground is heated, and so there's a convective current which is going up in the air. Now, so this was done an observation. In fact, it's a very important phenomenon for birds, and they clearly exploit this. There's a recent beautiful paper in Science, very recent, where what they've done is that they put GPS on birds that are migrating, like here, and they looked at the pattern in the migration times, and they reported all these trajectories of birds. They can make something of the order of 400 kilometers in a day. And the way they do it is that they use these thermals, so these ascending currents, and what they do is that they ascend these currents, and then they fly from one to the next without flapping wings. So essentially, they don't consume energy because they spiral up, then they go down, they sink to the next one, they go up again, and they never use the flapping of the wing, which is very consuming, and that's the way they make these kind of distances. And another observation which is not reported here is that if you look at the migratory paths of the birds, they're very dense in these thermals, so in these ascending currents. Now, the picture shown here clearly shows, though, that even though you have a mean current which is going up, actually this is very much turbulent, so you have the same type of fluctuations that I was discussing before. So what you should imagine is not that there's a column of air which you sit there and it transports you like an elevator up in the air, because what's going to happen is something much more similar to this one. So there will be a mean flow, but also there will be very strong fluctuations. So even if you're sitting somewhere and on average you're going up, you will be going up and down. And so there's an important problem of how they can possibly navigate in these currents, which are very fluctuating. This is a picture of the temperature field. As you can see, this is heated here and it's cold here, and you have convective plumes that are coming up, and this is the velocity field. As you can see, there are velocities going up, but you also have intermingled phases and periods where you actually go down. And so how do they navigate, what do they sense, and how they do this kind of things? And so what we decided to do was to try and figure out, again, very much similarly to what we did before, if we have to build a machine which does this, which, by the way, it's already exists. These are the gliders that people use, and they control by radio commands. So imagine I have to tell a glider how to fly. How should the glider fly in this kind of thermals? And so in order to have a policy of flight, we decided to use the following approach, which is to have an agent which is flying. We put some flying constraints, aerodynamic constraints, which are the usual ones in classical aerodynamics. The glider can control the angle of attack, which is the angle with respect to the horizontal, the banking, which is how much it's banking on the two sides, and the yaw, which is this direction of control. And then what we do is that we expose the agent to this really Benard convective fields, and we ask the agent to figure out what kind of sensory motor cues. For instance, should it measure temperature? Should it measure the vertical acceleration? Should it measure the vertical velocity? What kind of sensory motor cues should it pick in order to go up, to exploit the current as much as possible, and to gain height as fast as possible? Now, I won't get into the details, but the way we do this is by using reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning are techniques that are developed in order to, when an agent has to face an environment which is unknown and has to devise a policy of behavior in order to maximize some long-term reward. In our case, the long-term reward is the height that the agent is going to pick at the end. And so we use reinforcement learning. If some of you are interested, I can discuss these details. Most of them are explained in the book of Sarton and Barth on reinforcement learning, which is the classical reference on reinforcement learning. And so what once you use all this, which takes some time and some work, but at the end, that's the kind of plot that we produce. So this is the performance, which means how much height the agent peaks after a few minutes. And as you can see, this is by sensing the vertical acceleration, the torque, which is the difference in acceleration on the two wings, the vertical velocity, and the temperature. And this sensing all this is essentially equivalent to sensing just the vertical acceleration and the torque. So this way, we can identify what kind of sensory motor cues are the most useful. And so we reduce the long possible list to just vertical acceleration and torque. And then what we do is that we use these two cues, and we ask the agent to develop a policy of response to a certain vertical acceleration and a certain torque. And we go through a phase of learning. At the beginning, as you can see, the agent is sinking even though there's an ascending current. And at the end of the training, which takes a few hundred training episodes, this is what it does. It peaks several hundreds of meters in time scales of the order of minutes, which is comparable to what birds do. And if you look at the detail, what they do is that we essentially reduce this to a lookup table, where we have, this is the most coarse description that you can have. So you discretize vertical acceleration, you discretize torque, and you have three blocks. Either it's small, or large negative, or large positive. And so you have a table that is going to tell you when you have, for instance, here, two large negative acceleration and torques, what you should be doing on the bank angle. So this is telling you that if you detect this and you are in this state of bank angle minus 10 degrees, then you should reduce the bank angle even more to minus 15 degrees. This one is telling that if you have zero bank angle, you should bank away in order to get away from that region. And so this is the kind of policy that we are developing. And these are the kind of results that we get in the simulations. And what we are doing right now is to test this in the field on a real glider, which is what is shown here. And this is the kind of gain of height that we get in the field. And these are the kind of trajectories that you see, which are, again, they spiral around this ascending current, which is down here. You cannot see. And if you want to see what it looks at this height, so this is the glider, which is shown here, which is spiraling. And this is the kind of trajectory that they describe. This is done, usually it's done in these open fields. So the way the thermals are generated is that in this field, there's a lot of heat which comes. The ground is heated, and then it starts to have convective currents which are getting generated. In the summer, typically you can get it close to the sea, and then as you move in the winter, you have to go more and more into the desert. And so we benchmark this with respect to very well-known policy of flights that people have developed. In particular, there's Mr. Reichmann, who's a very famous guy in this field of soaring and gliding. He was 3 times world champion of soaring. He developed the policy of flight based on the acceleration. So there's a very well-known in the field policy of Reichmann. And then we compare this to our own. We are just beginning this. I'm telling you preliminary results. So we leave the glider at a certain height. And then we look at how, with the motor, because these gliders have motors, we switch off the motor, and we look at how they soar in these thermals. And so this is the comparison. And it looks like that this policy of flight is doing even better than the Reichmann one. We need more trajectories and we need more statistics, but it seems very promising. And once we have this, then of course we can implement this onto the glider. And this is useful in order to extend the autonomy of flight, so they don't need to consume the motors or the engines anymore. They can just use, like birds do, these ascending currents. And the other thing, of course, that we would like to do is to understand, once we have these policies, is to test, for instance, in the case of birds, what exactly they detect. So do they detect acceleration and torque? As we've shown, it's the most convenient thing to do. do they detect something else, what kind of decision they make. And so that's a long term, that's the long term plan. And with this, I conclude. These are the people I've been working in on different aspects of the problem. Jerome and Gautam are doing these experiments on gliders. Michael is mostly involved in this experiment with the flies. And it was supported when I started from Pasteur, CNRS, and INR, and now it's supported by UCSD and Simons Foundation. And thank you so much. So they seem to do pretty much what the gliders. One thing that I haven't told you is that at the beginning I told you that a priori we might control the yaw, the angle of attack, and the bank. It turns out that you can essentially forget about the yaw and the angle of attack. Most of what you do is to control the bank angle. This seems to be what birds as well do. So they seem to be, when they do this spiral, they mostly control by controlling the bank angle. That's what they do. And then so they go up, they get into the clouds, and then what they do is that they just let them sink down. There's another problem, which is how much do they, now at that stage, they control the angle of attack. Because with the angle of attack, they go straight, so they don't change the bank angle anymore. But with the angle of attack, they can sink more or less, and they can change the horizontal velocity. So in the thermal is mostly bank angle, and then in between thermals is mostly the angle of attack. But a priori, they might control the yaw as well, but it seems that's what they mostly control. Nobody knows. They probably do, because you cannot count on much more than that, except you might have some memory of past migrations that might help you. Which might play a role, because the migratory routes are pretty much fixed and stereotyped. And on the routes of migration, there's a higher density. So certainly it's important. How they visualize it's not quite known. Probably visual cues are important. In the case of gliders and pilots, the way they do it, it's actually that they look at birds. Because birds, they do it better than the pilots. So the first thing they told me when I went to the flying, we look at birds.
No, that's true.
Yes?
There's a large difference of size, right, between birds and gliders?
Yes.
How did it compare to the ascending current size?
So, yes. So the size is gonna affect is going to affect detail of this, but you can see that the different birds actually do this kind of soaring, and the size of these different birds is quite different actually. And even gliders, you can have gliders. I mean, the smallest glider that we are flying is like this, and then we have another glider which is much bigger, like much more. So the difference, I think, it's more in terms of how, for instance, I can tell you the difference that we observe for the gliders. It's more in terms of how you extract, for instance, the torque. The torque on the two wings is much easier to extract when the wings are much more extended for obvious reasons. But the policy of flight doesn't seem to be much affected by this by these differences. Of course, the way they fly is different. So the control, for instance, the stall angle or how much they can obtain in turn when they flap, this is different. This is different between the two. But the policy and the kind of movements that they do, the fact that they spiral, this kind of stuff seems to be pretty universal and irrespective of the size. Of course, if they're too small, they cannot do it. People have estimated that I think it's below 1 meter, they cannot, they just, there's not enough.
So if the goal of the bird is to get as far as possible in distance by using the descending field, is there any way it can because then the descending field tells us the stochastics and it's ready, but not, it can estimate whether it's getting a good slope down or a fast slope down.
So there's another policy which is called, that I didn't discuss. There's another guy who's very famous in gliding, which is called McCready. So McCready has a policy that is going to tell you how you should change the angle of attack, supposing, though, that you know the distance to the next one. So people have more or less discussed the case where you don't know exactly where it is, so you take risks. Observations are that birds seem to play safe. So if you compare with the glider, the policy that McGreedy tells you, birds don't follow that. They seem to be playing much more safely. So they sink much less than what you would expect based on McGreedy, which is probably reflecting the fact that they don't know exactly where it is. They have an estimate, but they don't know exactly where it is. And also because of fluctuations, you might sink more than what you expect. There's another thing that usually you say, I'm going to sink, but in a constant field. But you might have downdrafts that are going to bring you down more than what you would expect.
But this means a bird can actually find the downward slope, the current that is...
Well, then it becomes a little bit like in a thermal. So what you should do if you are in a downdraft or updraft. So the two, in fact, are coupled even in the phases where they go from one thermal to another. Because the idea that there's one thermal here, and then in the middle there's quiet air is not quite true. So they probably use, and but typically if it's relatively quiet, as I said, they just go down, they fly, they keep the bank angle, and they go like this. It's open, it's not known. Yes?
How long does it take for a bird to learn how to fly like this? And does it learn faster than your learning algorithm? And if it does learn faster, does it mean that it takes into account more variables to learn?
I don't know. I don't know. It's a good question. I would like to know the answer. I don't know. I don't know. But it's a good question. We'll get to birds. So far, we haven't got to birds. But that's a good question. So what we want, I mean, the philosophy, I think you got the idea, is that we try to develop first something based on physical constraints on what you would do. So this way, when you go and you start looking at birds, because otherwise it's purely observational, you go there with some hypothesis that might turn out to be totally wrong, but at least you test something. So the next stage will be once we are convinced that this policy of flight works in the field, then we'll get in touch with people doing birds, studying birds, and we'll see. And one of the questions is the one you raised, which is a very good one.